What's going on? I'm Rich DeMuro, and welcome to Rich on Tech Weekly. It is the November slide into the holidays. We're into November, and I'm telling you, the holidays will be here before you know it. So start that planning now for the gifts and the things you want to get, because here's what I do. Like I did on Halloween, I was literally shopping for my Halloween costume the morning of Halloween. Why did I wait until the morning of Halloween? I don't know. I had so many days before Halloween. I decorated the house the very first day you could, legally speaking, which is like, you know, the first weekend in October, I think. Whatever it was, I was like, all right, it's a cool day in LA, I'm decorating the house. And so I did that, and of course I'll take down those decorations and I'll put up the Christmas decorations right away, because I'm that person. I like to get the maximum. It is a lot of work to put the decorations out and to put them back, take them back, and so I like to get the maximum time out of those decorations. But when the holiday's over, I am done. I want those things out of my sight. So anyway, get ready for the slide into the holidays. You heard it here first. It is happening very, very quickly. This week, it's all about Apple. I know, before you send me those angry emails, hey, you were there when I talked about Pixel. You were there when I talked about Samsung. This show offers equal coverage to all of the major tech companies. This happens to be Apple's week because they launched a lot of new stuff. First off, Apple Intelligence. I'll tell you about that, and then I'll get into the new Mac computers as well. So, let's start with Apple Intelligence. Maybe you're already playing with this on your smartphone, on your iPhone. This is on the iPhone 15 Pro models and above. So iPhone 15 Pro, Pro Max, and the iPhone 16 models. So you have to update your software to iOS 18.1, and then you have to opt into Apple Intelligence in the settings. There's a new setting after you update your phone called Apple Intelligence and Siri. You say, yes, I want to be in, and then it will take you on a little wait list, and suddenly your phone will say, oh, you got it, a couple hours later, and now you have access to these things. Here's what you can do today. Enhanced writing tools, that's number one. So anywhere you see a blinker, a cursor blinking on the iPhone, you now have access to these new writing tools. So you can select some text, and you can rewrite it, you can summarize it, you can make it a list, a table. You can use AI-driven grammar adjustments. So I was talking to Grammarly up in San Francisco. I said, is this kind of like really bad for your business because it's now built into the iPhone? And from my experience, yeah, it's probably not a good thing. They said they were focusing more on business at this point because that's where the growth is, I guess. So you got those enhanced writing tools. That's probably the biggest thing. Like if you write something on Facebook or Instagram, you can highlight your text and proofread it, summarize it, change it, make it friendly, make it fun, make it business, whatever you want. That's throughout the whole phone. Now you've got a new natural Siri. So when you bring up Siri this time by pressing the side button, your phone is going to glow around the edges. That's kind of like the new thing. That's what they were teasing when they called the event Glow Time. Of course, none of this stuff was ready in time. So it was a really off sync, very rare miss for Apple in this respect. But that's what happened. And now it all makes sense why they were so into the glowing stuff when there was no glowing stuff when it came to the new iPhones until a month later. So now they glow. So when you bring up Siri, she glows, and that's very exciting, I guess. But Siri has gotten smarter, like Apple has said, for 10 years now, and I haven't seen it, but it's supposedly smarter. And you can also do this to it. So if you're saying something like setting a timer, and you say, oh, set a timer for 9 minutes, Siri will understand what you're trying to say, that you just wanted that timer for 9 minutes, whereas before you might have gotten an error back. Photos app, I know it's very confusing, the redesign of the Photos app, that is still being worked through. My advice there is to scroll all the way to the bottom and use the customization option, get rid of all the nonsense that Apple added and just get the most important stuff to you, which for me is basically just recent photos and my favorite photos. But that may vary depending on what you need. But now when you search in the Photos app, you can search by describing stuff inside your photos. So that will work for photos and videos. So if you want someone in a red bathing suit jumping into a pool, you can search that and it will find that picture for you. The cleanup tool. This is probably the thing that you might use the most. This is what we saw come to Samsung and Pixel months ago. Now it is available. Maybe years ago on the Pixel, but this is now available on the iPhone. So if you go in to edit a photo, you'll see a new cleanup tool, and it will erase unwanted objects and images from your unwanted objects and people from your images Very simply, very easily. It works really well. Again, it glows when you kind of brush over the thing that you want to erase. So again, there's that glow. And so that works. I mean, it's pretty good. It's not perfect, but it works pretty well. Then everything is sort of prioritized and summarized when it comes to your notifications and your emails. So you'll notice your notifications are sort of summarized and also grouped together, which I really like. You can also get priority email notifications. But again, think about this. All the features I've talked about, except for the writing, really pushes you deeper into that Apple ecosystem. You're not going to get a lot of these summarizations and things if you're not using Apple Mail, if you're not using Apple Messages, if you're not using Apple Photos. See what's happening here? It's Apple Intelligence. They're locking you even deeper into that Apple ecosystem. If you're all in it, it's great. It's going to work very nicely. But for someone like myself, who's using mostly Google products for my mail and my photos, and I use third-party apps for mostly everything, this is not going to work so well, because when I'm searching for stuff, it's not looking in iCloud. It's not looking in the Photos app. It's not looking in the Notes app on the iPhone. It's not able to look in the apps that I'm using. So maybe in the future, they'll hook into some of these third-party apps as well. Okay, this is pretty cool. In your phone app, you can now record phone calls and transcribe them. This is great for myself as a journalist, because I was on the phone with a PR person. I said, hey, do you mind if I record this call? It's much easier. I don't have to take notes. So now you can record the calls, not only get the recording of that conversation, but also get the full transcript and summarized notes. I find that the notes are a little hit or miss, but this is just the beginning. You can also record and summarize just regular audio recordings on your phone as well, which is really nice. Coming soon, this is coming in December, those personalized emojis, they call them Genmojis. So you'll be able to create an emoji of anything you want. So if you want a fish swimming on a bagel, you can make that. If you're chatting with someone, it will even suggest things in your chats to make emojis. Access to ChatGPT, so Siri will connect to ChatGPT come December. And then, of course, visual intelligence. You can actually scan things kind of like Google Lens using the iPhone camera. And they'll have an image playground as well, where you can generate images. I got a preview of that at the Apple event this week here in LA. And Apple's doing a really nice job with their image generation. It's very, very like Hollywood-esque. Like, they did a really nice job. So that's it. That's the Apple Intelligence. That's what you can do with it right now. Is it groundbreaking? It's good for iPhone users, I think. Is it as amazing as what we have on the Pixel and the Samsung? I think it's similar. I think that some things are better. Some things are a little worse. And, you know, at the end of the day, I think what Apple does best is make you work with Apple products more and more. So that's that. We'll be right back with more Rich on Tech Weekly. Welcome back to Rich on Tech Weekly. Rich DeMuro here, Rich on Tech. Welcome back to the show. We are here in Hollywood, where we are getting our first look at some new Mac computers with the M4 chip. They've got several models, everything from the iMac, which goes on your desktop. That comes in a bunch of fun new colors. Then you've got the MacBook Pro computers with some new features, including a screen that you have to see to believe. And finally, just when you thought that Mac Mini was small, it's gotten even smaller. Let's take a look. Apple taking to Hollywood to show off their latest, most powerful computers with M4 chips inside. They come with 16 gigabytes of RAM standard, up from 8, which makes everyday tasks speedier. New MacBook Pro laptops have a better camera and faster connectivity, plus a new anti-reflective screen option.
These are the brand new 16-inch MacBook Pros, and you have a choice of two different screen types. One has a nano texture, which sort of diffuses reflections. The other is your standard screen. Let's take a look at how this works. I've got the flashlight on my phone, and if you see when I put it on the screen, it's much more of a diffused reflection. When you come over to this screen, I can pretty much see the clear reflection of both my phone and the flashlight.
It does make a difference. New iMacs come with an improved camera and colorful accessories to match.
Here is the iMac M4 in every color. You've got blue, you've got purple, you've got pink, you've got orange, you've got yellow, you've got green, and last but not least, silver.
The new Mac Mini is so small, you might mistake it for an Apple TV.
This is the new Mac Mini. On the front here, you've got some USB-C ports, you've got a power indicator, headphone jack. On the back side, you've got your power cable connector, you've got Ethernet, HDMI, and then three more ports which you can use to connect monitors or also USB-C devices. And if you flip it over here, you've got the power button on the bottom.
It's Apple's first carbon neutral Mac and made from over 50% recycled materials.
That is it, fits in the palm of your hand.
Apple gave a sneak peek at AI features coming soon, like Siri with ChatGPT.
We're very clear with where we're integrating with ChatGPT. How do I use emoji on Mac? Say, I don't know how to do that and I want to add it.
Plus Image Playground, which generates images on the fly, even of people in your photo collection.
And those people, by the way, were pulled in from the photo library on this device.
Another demo shows how you can use multiple iPhones and an iPad to capture content.
So if I want to address my bite on this camera, so good. Oh, now I'm getting it, it's a mango. It's a little mango cake. Now when I'm done, all I have to do is press stop right here. Stops all the cameras.
Preview file of all four of your angles. So you can play it back, you can see that it's all synced nicely. And in the background, the full res files are transferring over the phones.
Plus easier social media editing with Final Cut Pro.
So if you've cut something for YouTube, you want to make a version for TikTok or Instagram, but you don't want to spend a ton of time managing every single shot.
AI Smarts automatically reconfigures widescreen videos into vertical. An impressive lineup. The Mini starts at $600, the iMac $1,300, and the laptops $1,600. And don't forget about education pricing for discounts.
What an incredible lineup. Is it bad to say that I want one of each? And by the way, that Mac Mini, can we say how small that thing is? I thought it was an Apple TV when I first saw it. And the thing I was most impressed with was that multi-camera control just using iPhones and an iPad. That is something that used to take a ton of specialized equipment and knowledge and know-how. Now that you can do it with just iPhones and an iPad is pretty mind-boggling. I'm Rich DeMuro. More Rich on Tech Weekly coming your way right after this.
We'll be right back with more Rich on Tech Weekly. Welcome back to Rich on Tech Weekly.
When it comes to smartwatches, Apple Watch gets a lot of the publicity, and that's great if you have an iPhone. But what if you have an Android, or specifically a Pixel phone? Well, that's where this watch comes into play. This is the Pixel Watch 3, and this year it gets a very big upgrade. You see that nice large screen? It just makes everything easier to see and read on this device. There's a few things I love about the Pixel Watch. First off, its simplicity. It's also really smart. It has the Google Assistant built in, which means your voice to text is always perfect and it can answer almost any question you can think of. And finally, the other thing I love about the Pixel Watch is the fact that it's also basically a Fitbit, so your health stats are excellent.
Google Pixel Watch 3 is going big. New this year, a larger screen option, 45 millimeters. It feels much roomier than the previous screen size, which is still available too. Pixel Watch makes a great companion if you have a Pixel phone and use lots of Google products, since they all work together. New this year, a voice recorder built in. I just wish it would email you a transcript for more helpful voice memos. What I love about this watch is having Google Assistant on my wrist. It's still one of the smartest voice assistants around.
Who starred in a remake of A Star Is Born?
A Star Is Born has a cast of more than 60 actors. Here are the first three.
Set a timer for 7 minutes.
7 minutes.
But let's be real, 99% of the time, you'll use this watch to find your phone. It can do that too.
Here in Los Angeles, you have some names to get right, like La Cienega Boulevard, Sepulveda Boulevard, the 405. Then, of course, you have the Getty Center.
I love the precision of voice to text and how it suggests related replies to messages.
It's also smart in other ways. For instance, when you go to sleep, it will automatically activate bedtime mode. That's something that you typically have to swipe down, tap here, and it says starting bedtime mode. But this way, your watch uses machine learning and AI to figure out when you go to sleep, and within 15 minutes, it'll stop all your calls and notifications and just let the important ones through.
It's compact enough to wear to sleep, and Fitbit provides the best sleep stats around. There's also offline Google Maps, the ability to view your Nest camera feeds, and use the watch as a remote for your Google TV. Plus, when you call a number with a long wait, the watch can hold for you and alert you when it's time to pick up. All the safety features are here, including heart rate notifications, SOS, and fall detection. Overall, Pixel Watch 3 is perfect if you're all in on the Google ecosystem. A great companion to the Pixel phone, the best way to use Google apps and services on the go, plus excellent health and fitness tracking from Fitbit.
So there you have it, Pixel Watch 3, great improvement with that nice big screen. Really works well if you use a lot of Google products, and I think it feels very smart. Thanks to Google Assistant built in, and of course Fitbit with that health tracking. But now there is just one more thing to answer. Do you like the circular design of the Pixel Watch, or do you like that square design of the Apple Watch? They're very different. You decide. I'm Rich DeMuro. More Rich on Tech Weekly coming your way right after this.
You're watching Rich on Tech Weekly. Welcome back to Rich on Tech Weekly. San Francisco, the epicenter of tech, and one website covers it all.
TechCrunch really is about giving people a front row to the future of technology. And so what's wonderful about Disrupt, where we are right now, is it brings the people that are focused on the site and that community here in one place. It's founders, it's seasoned operators, it's investors who want to look at the next thing.
Disrupt is where startups come to get noticed, with over 10,000 attendees from 35 countries and one hot topic.
Really, all of those sectors are talking about the same thing, which is AI. I mean, AI is basically the internet, it's mobile, it undergirds everything, and people are just trying to understand what's happening because it's impacting things so rapidly.
People come to get inspired, network, and build the next big thing. I scoured an entire floor filled with startups like MabLab.
MabLab was inspired after my co-founder and I lost a close friend to a drug overdose a little over 2 years ago.
The Harvard startup developing $5 test strips that detect spiked drinks and laced drugs.
You'd be able to quickly be able to test a drink that someone gave you, whether it's been spiked or not, or if the drug, being able to quickly test the drug, whether it's contaminated with a deadly substance like fentanyl or xylazine that could potentially harm you as little as 2 to 3 grains.
Now, what are you testing for?
Yeah, so we test for the 5 most likely lacing agents to cause an overdose, namely fentanyl, xylazine, methamphetamine, methadone, and benzodiazepine, more commonly known as roofies.
Results show within 3 minutes, MabLab targeting university health centers and pharmacies.
This issue is hugely prevalent. There's a little over 109,000 deaths that occur annually from this very issue and more than 5.2 million injuries. It equates to a little over a $12.4 billion cost to the U.S. medical system, which is just really the start of how many people suffer from this issue every year.
Meanwhile, Remento, helping to bring family history and memories to life.
Remento is all about capturing and preserving your family stories. So we're basically helping you find stories that your parents have by helping you choose questions for them.
Family members record answers to a series of questions.
They record themselves answering the question, and then we turn these recordings into written stories that we then print into a hardcover book.
QR codes let you access the original recordings. The process takes up to a year and costs $100. A similar service called Story calls family members with questions on a traditional phone.
So at the end of the day, everyone has stories to tell. And for a lot of people that may have arthritis, maybe they can't type, or maybe they don't want to write, or they don't really know how to start. Doing everything over the phone makes it a lot simpler.
Yuvi is a solution for hair salons that actually dispenses hair color automatically, reduces the waste, and makes it very efficient and sustainable for salons to do hair color for their clients. So hairdressers can create colors that they couldn't have created that easily with tubes of color. It only uses 11 hair color cartridges, which means that you can save a lot of space. And for the clients, when you come back to the salon, your hairdresser will actually have your formula perfectly safe.
Food tech also on display.
This chocolate's going to enhance my brain, apparently.
Astrius building an AI wellness app with a sweet hook, performance chocolates.
So they have all the micronutrients that an elite performer or a surgeon or astronaut requires to do their day-to-day high cognitive tasks.
$5 a box and packed with various nutrients, they're currently being tested on the International Space Station.
Instead of taking 17 vitamins, you're taking one delicious chocolate.
That's Rich on Tech. I'm Rich DeMuro. That's it for now. See you next week for another Rich on Tech Weekly.